and welcome to Neighborhoods Today. I'm Nick Stefanisi, and we're here at Our Lady of Mount Carmel in the Williamsburg section of Brooklyn to celebrate with them their annual feast to Our Lady of Mount Carmel and St. Paulinus. With me today are Father David Quesada, the administrator of the parish, Sam Caggiano, a member of the executive board and a former number one capo, 1983-84, and Sarge Miranda, general chairman and former number one capo, 1981-82. I want to start off by saying that we're thrilled to be here at this very festive occasion, and we thank everyone for allowing us to be here with them and share it. Sam, at this time I'd like you to ask you if you would give us some background on the meaning of this festival.
Well, the festival to me came from Italy, from our forefathers, and it's a joyous thing and a religious thing. The religious end is honoring our patron saint, Our Lady of Mount Carmel and San Bolina. And the joy of it is the things that we meet our friends that come from as far as Florida, Chicago, California, Connecticut. They come from all over. People that lived here and moved away, and they come back to us. And we say hello.
Sounds great, Sam. Sarge, how long have you been involved with the festival?
I've been involved in Our Lady of Mount Carmel Festival, well, since my father took over, which is about 40 years ago.
Father, since you're the relative newcomer to this, to the parish and to this festival, I'd like you to give our viewers a little idea about your feelings about the parishioners and their participation in this festival.
I guess I'm the new kid on the block in a lot of ways, and over the last 6 months that I've been here at Our Lady of Mount Carmel, one of the greatest things that has been part of my work here at Our Lady of Mount Carmel Church has been the development of the feast. And I must say, in honesty, it's been a very joyous occasion. People have come together and they've worked so very, very hard. I mean, people have spent hours and hours, almost every Tuesday and almost every Wednesday night of their free time, coming here to make this festival. And they don't just do it for themselves. I think the most important thing is that they do it for other people. They do it in honor of San Paulino and Our Lady of Mount Carmel, and it's brought a lot of people together, and it gives a great deal of joy and a great deal of happiness. I think sometimes our life can be a little rough at times. This is something to celebrate. These are days to really enjoy our church, to enjoy our faith, and to enjoy a festival.
That's great. It seems as if they've really succeeded in bringing the joy of the occasion to you, Father, after such a short time here. What I'd like to do now is ask maybe Sam first, if you would give me a little bit of the specifics about the Giglio, which obviously is the center point of the festival.
Well, like Father said, we started to build a new face on the Giglio. We started that in August to make molds, and then we got the rest of the crew to start coming in with the carpenter work and stuff. And putting it together, it's hard work, like he said, but we do this from the heart. It's in our system and tradition. We grew up this way. These were our parents' ways, and we grow right into it.
Maybe you could tell me, Sam, about how big is the Giglio actually?
Well, the Giglio actually stands 67 feet from the ground to the top of San Bolino. It's 67 feet.
And what about approximately, how much does it weigh?
I would say about 4 ton. With a band and the singer and master of ceremonies on it.
That's fantastic. Really a great occasion. Sarge, about how many men does it take to carry the Giglio? How many?
Approximately each structure takes about 110 men. But to run the day between the young men on the ropes and our lifters, approximately we have about 300 men that we have to organize, instruct, take care of. But they do most of the work for the day of the festival.
I'm sure some of the viewers, just seeing the things that are happening, don't realize what goes into it to put together the amount of people that it takes to coordinate this kind
of thing. Well, it is work, Nick, but it's a work of love, really. Nobody gets paid to go underneath. It's a penance, so to speak. But everybody involved really loves what they're doing, really.
Well, I think anyone from the neighborhood really feels that joy and love that comes out at this time of year. It's really a fine thing.
Well, we're kind of branching out from the neighborhood because of the amount of lifters we need. We got fellows from the Bronx, Queens, that heard about our feast and asked to be recruited and gladly accepted.
That's really interesting. At this time, with some more information on our structure, I'd like to give you Danny Smith.
First of all, I'd like to introduce my committee who worked so hard throughout the year. On my extreme right is Mr. Pat Grandy. Next to me is Mr. Martello, and to my left is James Delacono. Okay, took us just about 9 months to complete this project. We started back in August. Some of the molds that we used were built back in 1927, are decayed now, and they had to be repaired. All right, the molds are made out of, the forms here are made out of paper mache, and they're set into a plastic cast, and they're left to dry for a few days, and that process takes a long time. I'd like to introduce Mr. Martello, and he's going to talk a little bit about how the tradition was brought over from Italy. Mr. Martello?
Hello, thank you. And then I was 24 years, I made the first one in this country. It's 1927, see? And since then, I made it over here, in Brooklyn, in Astoria, Harlem, Cliffside, New Jersey. I brought it all over. And then now I'm too old, I ain't doing nothing. I'm glad these kids that took over, and I like to help them. And I'm glad they did a good job, a nice job, and God bless them and everybody.
Patty, would you like to say a few words?
Thank you. It was a pleasure working with all of you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for your time.
Before we show the first lift, I have some information I'd like to get to our viewers about what's going on out here. Sarge, in terms of the structure, where does its name come from? What does it mean?
Well, the structure is called the Giglio. Instead, a lot of people call it a tower. But we who know, we call it a Giglio. And the translation of Giglio is lily. I think Father will get into the story of San Paolino about Giglio and the boat and the whole story. But our structure there is called a Giglio for a specific reason.
That's great. Thank you, Sarge. Sammy, for our viewing audience, in terms of what's going on out here, what is the Capobaranz and what are his responsibilities?
The Capobaranz is the number one man of the feast. He's in charge of all the lifts and movements of our structure, boat structures. He is the one that passes the stick to the honoraries and his crew down the line.
Thank you, Sam. As another former number one man, a Capobaranz, do you have anything to add to that, Sarge?
Certainly. Being number one man that day is quite an honor. And to do the right thing, when I say do the right thing, to make sure every one of our past garbos, our future garbos, are happy that day. You're the boss, but you're second as far as doing the right thing. You just got to do what's in your heart to do what's right.
And now, I think another interesting thing I should bring out is that this year's Capobaranz is, for the first time, an Irish, Jimmy Smith. And without further ado, I'd like to get into our first lift. So here's Jimmy Smith with our lift of the Giglio.
All right. Move it back.
Move it back.
Yeah, we're coming back.
Okay, follow me. Don't worry.
This day means a lot to me because it's a family tradition, and my father did it, and all of my brothers do it every year. So it's a very deep family thing, and it's a very religious thing for me.
To us, it means our devotion to God, Mary, our mother, and our church. It is something we have been doing since we were children, brought over by our parents, who taught us the love for God. And of course, our country follows that.
This is the greatest feast because it comes of the people and for the people, and the people put this on, and they keep this community vibrant, and everybody loves this feast. I love it. I make it number one.
I am so happy to be here because I think it's such an inspirational thing. I come here year after year, and to me, it's like coming home.
Father, I understand you've just returned from Nola, Italy, where this tradition originated, and you've seen the feast there. Maybe you could give us a little comparison between our humble attempt at the feast and what you've seen in Italy.
Well, probably the greatest comparison that you can make between here in Brooklyn and in Nola in Italy is the simple fact that in Nola, the town is divided into 8 sections, and that they have 8 structures, 8 gigli, and they have a boat also. Here in Brooklyn, we have the giglio and we have the boat. And I guess if you would look at it, that's probably the greatest thing that comes to your mind is the difference. And if you notice here in the United States, our streets are much wider. There's a great deal of passageway. Whereas in Nola, the streets are very, very narrow, and it becomes much more difficult to bring the structure down the streets. Here it is difficult for ourselves here. Can you imagine these streets that are very tiny and narrow and how they bend and wind through this small little town in Nola? The thing that I find, though, to be very, very similar between the feast here in Brooklyn and the feast in Nola is the simple fact that there is a great deal of excitement. There's a great deal of enthusiasm. There's a great deal of happiness on the part of the people of Nola and the people here in Brooklyn and the people that come to our feast from different parts of the city, different parts of the country. I really am very impressed by that. And there's this devotion, which is probably the key thing throughout it all, the devotion that these men in Nola and these men here in Brooklyn have for San Paulino and also for Our Lady of Mount Carmel.
I think you hit it right on the head there, Father. And one of the things that impresses me about this feast is, although I've been here all my life, being a member of a different parish in the community, seeing the feeling that goes into this feast from everybody involved here, it's like contagious. It makes you want to be a part of it. It's unbelievable. Sarge, I know the procession of St. Paulino serves another purpose. Maybe you could fill us in on that.
Well, I'm sure San Paulino, if he was here, like he did when he was alive, he lived for the people of Nola. And he would go to each door personally to greet his people, his parishioners, his followers. This is what our procession does. We bring San Paulino around to the people who can't come to visit him in our church, like the elderly, the sick, the shut-ins, whatever. And this is a religious feast, regardless what anybody thinks. But going back to our procession, this is the main reason for our procession, is to bring San Paulino to the people.
Which is a wonderful gesture to people who have been participating and no longer can. This festival takes place over approximately a 20-day period. One of the other traditions, one that we were just speaking about, that take place before Giglio Sunday, is the procession in honor of St. Paulino. At this time, I'd like Father David Quesada to tell us how the feast in the honor of St. Paulino began.
St. Paulinus of Nola was born in the year 353 in France of a senatorial family and was educated under the poet Ausonius. He became the governor of the province of Campania. Then Paulinus married a Spanish Christian woman named Teresina. His children were grown when Paulinus became a convert to the Catholic Church. He was baptized in Spain, and after the death of his wife and children, he gave away his wealth, took a vow of chastity, and entered religious life. In the year 394, he was ordained a priest and sent to the little town of Nola. It was here that he was raised to the office of bishop in the year 409. It was shortly after his elevation to bishop that the town of Nola was raided by Mediterranean conquerors. During the raid, Paulinus escaped with the children of Nola. Upon his return to Nola, he came upon a widow whose only living son was captured during the raid. Paulinus immediately made arrangements with the conquerors to exchange himself for this poor widow's son. He was then taken in bondage to North Africa. A Turkish sultan heard of his great sacrifice that he had made and immediately set out for North Africa to meet with the raiders. There he bartered for the life of Paulinus and the freedom of the other prisoners taken in the raid. When Paulinus returned to Nola, the people came to greet him, carrying lilies, in Italian, gigli, the flower that shows the purity of heart and love for mankind. The giglio, the structure, was built in Paulinus's honor and is carried every year by the people in remembrance of this great feat of this great saint. After his death, the carrying of the giglio was dedicated to the sacred penance for the souls in purgatory and for the remission of the sins of the living.
Giglio Sunday is a big, big day in terms of this festival. That, of course, is the time when the men of the parish dance the giglio and boat down the streets in front of the parish hall. Sammy, what can you tell us about this day?
Well, Giglio Sunday begins here at 8 a.m. sharp. The band goes out and picks up all the gabbaranzas, the honoraries, and all the dignitaries of the feast. Then we march back into church and we hear Mass. After Mass, we stop at Bomonti's yard. We have a little coffee and whatever. And then the men get to carry the giglio. We usually try to take off at 1 o'clock, but it never happens because either Father's late or somebody else is late. And, you know, things go that way. But they really do have a good time doing it.
I think sometimes just the crowd makes the scheduling impossible. It really is tremendous sight to see.
The crowd helps delay that too. I don't want to blame Father for all of it.
Sarge, as a former Capo Paranza, maybe you can give us a little personal insight into what it feels like out there in the street on this very special day.
Well, I'm sure everybody sets himself out in an organization or a job. You set goals for yourself. And when you join the feast committee, it's everybody's goal to be a capo number one. I wish everybody could enjoy that feeling. It is a complete feeling of joy. Your whole body, you think nothing but good thoughts that day when you're number one out there. Quite an honor, feeling just the greatest feeling you ever want to achieve. So one of your goals, whatever they are in life, I've achieved one. I became number one on the Mount Carmel feast.
I think I'm beginning to get very jealous here. I'm surrounded by two former number one capos, and it sounds fantastic.
Have that feeling.
Father, from your point of view, maybe you can add something of a personal note, your feelings throughout that special day.
First of all, we try never to be late to start the special day. But probably one of the greatest feelings is there a feeling of many, many young people I mean, the lift is basically our men in their 20s and 30s. And to see so many, many young people first come to Mass and to attend Mass and to be filled with the moment, that faith of that moment, and then come out and celebrate their togetherness, their bond of friendship that is created in the church and then brought out to the streets. And I find that to be a very, very emotional moment for myself. When I walked into the church on Giglio Sunday and saw the enthusiasm that was there in the people, the happiness, I was overwhelmed by it myself. And I really feel in life we don't have enough things to celebrate. And this was just a good day because we celebrated together and had a good time together.
That's great. I think you've captured the spirit very well, Father, for being here such a short time. We've spent some time talking about the events of this day. Now we'd like to show you some highlights of that very, very special day in this feast.
It's very difficult to say, how do you feel about the feast? To me, it's like life. I wait for this every year. I've been in it since I was, as far back as I can remember, 6 years old. My father put me on a statue when I was about 8 years old, sang my first song. And it's just life. It's fantastic. It's just something spectacular. It's in our blood. And we were brought up with it. And it's going to stay there, and I hope that the younger generation gets to feel exactly as we do, that they have it in their blood, and they will continue this tradition, because it's something that cannot be forgotten.
This day is a day of joy and celebration. We find a living tradition, a tradition that has begun in Italy, and it's carried on today by their ancestors. But more importantly, we find a celebration, an expression of faith of these people, a faith in God and a faith in their church, a faith in their patron saint.
which brings them together as a community, as one church together in this faith in God, in this Catholic faith that they have. This is an expression of tradition and faith together. This is what makes it such a day of joy and of celebration.
Historic occasions for our neighborhood each year when we have the Feast of San Paulino that commemorates a struggle that took place in the home of many of the people who come here in Naples, Italy, including my ancestry. And this is a feast that's celebrated throughout the Neapolitan world and means a great deal to people of Neapolitan ancestry throughout the world, especially here in Williamsburg.
This day means a lot to us because it's been a tradition around this neighborhood for years and our fathers before us, and it's been a part of our life for the last 15 years. And it's a very, very important day for us, and I hope I can keep continuing till I'm as old as they come.
This day is a special day because a lot of different ethnic groups gathered together, especially the Italians, to celebrate a most memorable feast that happened back in Italy. And it's a chance for me to meet people, to talk with people, and to have a good day, and also to give them something and make a little money on the side.
I come here every day. I'm an American descent, but I'll never forget my blood and tradition and generation. We are Napolitan from Bruciano, Cisterna, Napoli, Candanola.
As you can see by now, this festival is just chock full of tradition. Another being the Questa, meaning the distribution of the blessed bread throughout the parish. Sam, maybe you can tell us a little something about this tradition.
Well, actually, we go out in three different groups, the north side, the south side, and we extended to Greenpoint a couple of years ago. And actually, the blessed bread is more or less, Questa means like you're begging. That is the word, you're begging for money. And we go out, we enjoy ourselves that day, and then we try to bring everything to the people. Like Sarge mentioned and Father mentioned, we go to the people of the neighborhood, and this is our way of also collecting a few funds for the feast.
Well, Sam, I know one of the things you mentioned rings through with me. Coming from the other side of Meeker Avenue, St. Stanislaus Parish, it was a real thrill for me a couple of years ago when you came there and branched out and went beyond the limits of your parish with the Questra. And I see that the people there have just really gotten into it by the response that you've gotten.
Well, you know, we try to bring it out. And, you know, it's like everything else. You branch out and you try to get ahead in things. And what else could I say? But okay, we try.
Father, again for you, as a first-timer in this particular aspect of the feast, how did it feel to go out into the streets of your parish and beyond, out into the other parts of the community?
I probably found that to be one of the most fascinating things, is going out and going through the streets, walking through the streets, watching people, and getting to know a new neighborhood. You know, coming into this neighborhood today was a different experience for me, and I really haven't gotten a feel for the neighborhood. Walking through the streets, and I've walked through many of them these past few weeks, I know the neighborhood a lot better now than I did before. One thing that's very interesting is that people wait. People are waiting for us to come with this bread. People are waiting to give their love and devotion to San Paulino, and that was truly inspiring.
It is. It's an amazing thing to watch. People really get into it. Sarge, maybe you can maybe compare this year as opposed to some of the others in the long amount of time you've been doing that.
The comparison will start with Agüestro. Walking through the streets, we actually ran out of bread. But what showed me that this feast this year would be a great success, the people were handing us money just walking through without receiving the bread. To continue on past Agüestro, the streets, I've never seen them so crowded. The stands, we extended another block and a half. And again, the crowds have been orderly, respectful, just people coming down to our parish, seeing our church, and having a good time.
You know what's always been amazing to me, at least in the last few years, is that one of the things you have to understand is that the people in Greenpoint, naturally not coming to this church every Sunday, wouldn't know exactly when they're coming, but they're still waiting. They're still there. They're so thrilled that you've been coming over there. It's just been a great thing. What we'd like to do now is to share some scenes of some of the very special things that happen in this celebration with you.
Good morning, everybody. As you know, today is our official day for selling the bread, which we call Agüestro. We'll be going out through the streets of Williamsburg, the north side and the south side, and also Greenpoint. We have three groups with three bands going out. This is a way we provide funds for the festival, pay for the expense of the festival. Right now they're in Jimmy Smith's yard. He's our number one carbo this year. They're in his yard having breakfast. They take a tab for all the expenses of the breakfast. And we go out and we enjoy ourselves today. This is our day of enjoyment.
Basti's mother, one of the capos of Our Lady of Mount Carmel feast. Today is one of my happiest days, as today is called Guesta Days. I prepare for all my son's friends and my daughter Lucille, with my sister-in-law Sue, and my other helpers do all the cooking for our Guesta of the North Side Basti's crew. Today is a happy occasion for me, my son, and my family. May everyone enjoy this day.
At this point, we'd like to take you back to some more of the lifts of the Giglio and the boat, and plenty of other scenes from Giglio Sunday.
The feast means an awful lot to me. It means a lot of different things, really. Having been a tradition in my family for many, many years, it's something that I looked forward to ever since I was a child, looked forward to the day that I would be able to stand in front of the Giglio and give the commands, as I have come to do now as a capo in the feast. It means continuing a tradition, continuing and keeping our community together. Only with the feast can we do this. Keep the church going, keep the neighborhood as strong as it is, and keep a tradition that has been going on for centuries alive here in Brooklyn in the United States. There's so much other things that I couldn't mention as far as what it means to me, but really that's what it is. It comes from the heart. It's a devotion not only to San Paulino, for my ancestors, but also to my parish and community, Our Lady of Mount Carmel, and the devotion I have to her. So, as I said, it's a combination of many, many things, and it's the thing we look forward to throughout the whole year. We work the whole year long for this day. It comes and it goes very quickly, but we love it anyway, and we hope everyone else enjoys it as much as we do. Thank you.
I've been a parishioner here 56 years. All my kids got married here, christened, baptized. And then, like I said, my great-grandchildren come in here. To me, it is one of the greatest honors of the world.
Well, only in America can you have a feast, an Italian feast, with so many people remembering the old country, remembering their old heritage. And that's what's beautiful about this neighborhood in this country. This is the epitome of what America is really all about.
Everybody eats. They love to eat sausage. And what I have here is what they call sweetbread. Nobody has that. We make our own sausage here, and it's golden brown. I give them a good sausage sandwich, and I give them what they call a hot peppers, you know, the real long hot peppers. Then the next day they think of me because it's so hot and they're beautiful.
It is a pleasure to be here. I've been born and raised here, and I come every year.
In terms of this feast, we've been talking a lot about things that represent certain things and traditions. I think the dancing of the children's boat really gets to the core of the traditions that we're speaking about. Father, maybe you can give us a little insight into that.
Well, in my own opinion, I think that one of the most important things is to maintain traditions in life. And if you don't incorporate a child into the traditions of some feast or some parish occasion, you begin to lose the young people. And I think what we have done here, and I give a great deal of credit to the men that work on the executive committee for coming up with this idea of a child's boat and a child's giglio, and those two nights where you incorporate children into a feast and you give them something to look forward to. This tradition in this neighborhood will never die because the children are incorporated from a very, very early age. Today, so many traditions have fallen away and have gone by the boards. This tradition, I am sure, will stay and will continue because of the young people involvement from when they're 5 and 6 years old. There were 55 young boys on the rope gang who lifted the giglio and the boat for the children during the week.
That's fantastic. And you know, you're talking about tradition, but one of the things that strikes me as you're speaking is the truth is sitting right here with us, because with us here today we have two former number one capos, and they both go back and trace their roots back all the way to the children's boat. Sarge, maybe you can throw something out to us about that particular day in your life.
Well, when I was a younger fella, I started carrying wine for the lifters. Well, my father was a lifter, and at that time they were allowed to have a little drink once in a while in the Vigilio. But I go from there to the present, when I see my son carrying that pole at my lift and the straining on his face, reminds me when I did it. I was a carrier, and I also have a little grandson that's 2 years old that knows this feast in and out. So I get a lot of flashbacks when I see the Giglio carry. Really.
That's really great. Sam, how about you? You have some thoughts back that far?
You know, today we have a rope gang. Years ago when I came in, we didn't have a rope gang. I went as a lifter. I was quite young then, but he grows on you, Nick. What can I tell you? For the love and devotion of this feast to us, it's everything. It's in your system, it's in your blood, in your heart.
Well, I think our viewers will appreciate the examples we really have right here of the devotion and the honor and the tradition that this feast is all about. What you're about to witness are the young boys of the community dancing their own replica of the boat. And it ensures that this deep-rooted tradition is carried on from generation to generation.
Take it out! Look at the ball!
Because I do it in honor of St. Paulinus and the church, and my family been in it through the whole life. Thank you. I do this in honor of my church and honor of St. Paulinus.
We lift the cheerleader and the boat because we like it and we think it's fun.
It's an honor to our church and it's lots of fun.
We do it to represent our church and St. Paulinus.
I've been invited here today to join with Father Quesada and the others on what is a great celebration for this community.
The day here for all of us is bringing families together under the banner of Our Lady. All of us here enjoy ourselves as a family of the church and a family of blood.
Well, I'm happy to see neighborhoods today here because they're at every great feast and every great festival in Greenpoint and Williamsburg. And we love it, and I'm waiting for Al D'Amato to show up because he leads the parade, and it's just a great day.
We come every year for Our Lady of Mount Carmel Feast, and we just love Giglio Sunday. We get such a proud feeling when we see all this strain on the men's faces, the way they carry the Giglio. And our whole family comes, and we're just so proud to be here every year.
I know through the course of our show, some people had to notice the sentry board to our left, which hangs on the parish wall. Sam, maybe you can tell me a little something about it.
Yeah, Nick, maybe about 25 years ago, we instituted what is called a sentry club. These were $100 donors to put their name on a board for advertisement. Within the years, it grew. As you can see by now, we got a 12 by 12 board, and if I need more room, we completely full. If I need more room, I'll put another board on top of it. Incidentally, our sign maker for them boards, all the plaques that are up there are made by Buster Miranda, and I nailed them on the wall. So that's it with the Century Board.
Okay, thank you, Sammy. What I'd like to do now is ask each of our panelists in a few words to tell me what this festival means to them personally. Sarge, maybe we can start with you.
Well, me personally as General Chairman, it's a beautiful thing to see all our preparation that we did in the past 10 months finalized and see how nice it came out. Secondly is to see your friends, your fellow parishioners, greet each other, shake hands, kiss one another, honoring Our Lady and San Paulino. It's a really nice feeling. Few words.
Well said, and a job well done too. Sammy, how about you?
Well, it's got to be in you. You got to be in the line. It don't have to be in the line, but it's got to be in you. And we lived it. We live for this thing from year to year, from one day to another. That's all we talk about all year. The feast closes on the 16th. The 17th, we're already discussing next year's celebration.
And I know that's true. Father, I know for you this has to be rather special. The enthusiasm that's come from you as a first-year administrator of this parish is just incredible. And I know you feel at home already, but maybe you can add something to what Sarge and Sam have told us.
There's just one thing I wanted to add. I was here last year for the feast, and as I drove away in the car and I was going home, I said, I'd love to be in that parish because they seem to have such a great time together. And I tell you, this feast has been a time of faith for me to see the devotion of so many people, but it's also been a time of having a good time together. And I've really enjoyed that part and to see the expression of the people's faith. And that's probably the bottom line on the whole thing. It's friendship and it's faith.
Well, I know just by the amount of affection that has been shown to you while we've been out here today that obviously you've captured the feeling in terms of the parishioners here.
I sure hope so.
I hope that our viewers and all of us have learned something about the tradition of the people in this community. It's a tradition that pays tribute to the past, nourishes the present, and brings hope for the future. I'd like to say thanks to Father David Quesada, Sam Caggiano, and Sarge Miranda for all their help in putting this together. And let's not forget there were literally hundreds and hundreds of people who added to this help and put this feast together. I fully realize now all the love, warmth, and enormous energy that exists in this, our neighborhoods today.